Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So to begin with, I'd like to express my gratitude of once again being allowed to visit Mayapur and having the opportunity to offer some humble service here by sharing a few thoughts and realizations. And of course, first of all, I would like to ask for the blessings of all the assembled Vaishnavas and senior devotees, Srila Prabhupada disciples, that whatever I'm saying may be of some little meaning and some little inspiration. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. So we're reading from Canto 8, Chapter 6, verse 29 to 31, and 31 is written on the board. So I will just read the translations of 29 and 30. The demigods approached Bali Maharaj, the son of Virochana, and sat down near him. Bali Maharaj was protected by the commanders of the demons and was most opulent, having conquered all the universes. Text number 30. After pleasing Bali Maharaj with mild words, Lord Indra, the king of the demigods, who was most intelligent, very politely submitted all the proposals he had learned from the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Lord Vishnu. And again, no purport. So now we're reading text 31. Tatvaru chataratyasya. Tatvaru chataratyasya. Tatranyeye suradipa. Tatranyeye suradipa. Sambarurishtane mischa. Sambarurishtane mischa. Yecha Tripura Vasinaha. Yecha Tripura Vasinaha. Tatvaru Chattaraityasya. Tatranyeye Suradipa. Sambarurishtane mischa. Yecha Tripura Vasinaha. Somebody chant.
Yeah.
appetite, all those words. Two, but arochita were very pleasing. Dadyasya to Bali Maharaj. Tata as well as anye others. Ye who were Asura Adipaha, the chiefs of the Asuras. Sambara Sambara Aristanemi Aristanemi Cha also ye others. Sorry, others who Cha and Tripura Vasina, all the residents of Tripura. Translation by Srila Prabhupada. The proposals submitted by King Indra were immediately accepted by Bali Maharaj and his assistants, headed by Sambara and Aristanemi, and by all the other residents of Tripura. Purport. It appears from this verse that politics, diplomacy, the propensity to cheat, and everything that we find in this world in individual and social negotiations between two parties are also present in the upper planetary systems. The demigods went to Bali Maharaj with a proposal to manufacture nectar, and the daityas, the demons, immediately accepted it, thinking that since the demigods were already weak, when the nectar was produced, the demons would take it from them and use it for their own purposes. The demigods, of course, had similar intentions. The only difference is that the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Lord Vishnu, was on the side of the demigods because the demigods were his devotees, whereas the demons did not care about Lord Vishnu. All over the universe, there are two parties, the Vishnu party or God-conscious party and the godless party. The godless party is never happy or victorious, but the God-conscious party is always happy and victorious. So, yes, the Leela further unfolds, and I guess this theme of the good conquering the bad, the divine conquering over the demoniac, the good, the evil, this is really a theme of existence in the material world, actually. So, and as Prabhupada so nicely says, there are these two parties, the God-conscious party or the godless party. So, and Prabhupada even takes up the similar theme in his sutra for the Back to Godhead magazine, for example, that he says, yes, Godhead is light, nescience is darkness, where there is Godhead, there is no nescience. So it's actually, it's Krishna polarizing quite a bit in presenting the absolute truth. Sometimes a preacher might be accused of polarizing, but it's actually not the preacher, but it's Krishna actually polarizing, right? Maya and Krishna, darkness and light. So, and also, you know, these leelas, depending on our faith, we might simply take them as interesting stories or analogies. Or if we have stronger faith in Krishna, then yes, we accept them as historic accounts, but not always we are aware that actually Krishna is performing these leelas to instruct us. It actually concerns us. So, and I would like to try and take this pastime on a more personal, individual level, so we can more clearly understand how what we can really learn and extract from that. So as we know, demons and devotees in previous ages, they were in different universes, then on different planets, then in different countries, but in Kali Yuga, in the same body. So we all have this demoniac and divine nature in our hearts. And yeah, this churning process, which is taking part here between the demigods and demons, this is actually also going on in our hearts. And there's also this battle there. Like Hiranyakashipu, you know, he's the personification of false ego, of envy. So we all have this little Hiranyakashipu there residing in our heart, manifesting in lust, anger, greed. As we know, Kam, Krodh, Lobh, Moha, Mada, Matsarya, the six enemies, envy especially. Envy, so subtle. Envy is like the most subtle form of Hiranyakashipu, we can say. And in the fifth canto, there is a verse where in the word-to-word translation, it says there, Kalaha, the envious, and Prabhupada puts in brackets, almost everyone. So this includes us also. Very easily we might think, yes, others are envious, but not me. No, of course not. But no, that's why Prabhupada writes, almost everyone. So this is the root problem of material existence. Envy comes about because we want to be the supreme enjoyer. And as soon as somebody else has something also, then we become envious. And we, or even to inferiors, there's envy there. We try and push people down just to establish our superior position. So these things are all going on, and we do have this internal battle there. In the same way, like here, Lord Vishnu is saying, yes, at the moment, the demons seem to be favored. They are stronger. So in the same way, we also might go through phases in our spiritual practice where the demoniac element becomes more strong. We might break the principles. We might be, you know, stopping to chant 16 rounds or whatever. We might be fading away a little bit, engaging more into sense gratification again. So this is all this internal battle there. And this is not only going on in our hearts, but it is also naturally going on with people, devotees around us, who are also having these two natures within their hearts. Right? So this is how we experience all different kinds of tension, conflicts, this, that, and the other thing. So, and in Krishna consciousness, the churning process, like here the demigods, the demons, cooperating under the guidance of Lord Vishnu. So same thing is actually also there in our spiritual practice, that actually the main and foremost principle of this churning of the anattas, which we are experiencing in Krishna consciousness, comes through cooperation. That's the main and foremost principle, which brings all kinds of poison to the surface, right? Just in the same way how Lord Vishnu is saying, yes, there will be poison produced, but don't be fearful. Don't be fearful. So in the same way, when we take up that process of Krishna consciousness, all kinds of things are coming to the surface, which we did not even realize that they're there in our hearts, right? Sometimes young devotees share this, that all of a sudden they feel actually more contaminated, they feel more dirt than before they even took up the process of Krishna consciousness. So it's not, of course, that the process of Krishna consciousness is contaminating the heart. No, but that churning process brings things to the surface. We become aware of them, right? So it's similar process like making ghee. When we boil the butter, all kinds of foamy things and milk solids and all kinds of things are coming to the surface, and we are meant to scoop them off, throw them out. So same thing is really going on in the process of Krishna consciousness. That churning process brings up all kinds of things, especially the more intensely we put ourselves in the fire of devotional service in cooperation with devotees. That's highly purifying, highly purifying. I'm sure we all have that experience. You know, the more intense the service situation is, the more the fire of purification is switched on high. Like Prabhupada Marathon, or festivals, Janmashtami, or Spiritual Master comes. So whenever the fire of devotional service in cooperation is more intense, so many things come up. Right? And sometimes we are surprised, oh, why is there all of a sudden so much argument and tension, and before everything was so much more peaceful, but now all of a sudden, oh, I'm getting agitated and angry and so on. So that is this principle of the churning process, incorporation. So many things come to the surface. So, and then not only that, also, as it is described, also some auspicious byproducts will also come, like some gems, some beautiful ladies, was described in the yesterday's verses. So same thing, also in the process of devotional life, there's also some little opulences coming. As we become more purified, we might receive some little opulences, we might become more famous, we might get some influence, some power, we become a little more attractive. Basically, we get some little drops of Krishna's opulences in minute quantities, right? Some little opulence, some little wealth, whatever, some paraphernalia, some assets, and. So, and again, the demoniac side in us will want to enjoy them, right? That's why Lord Vishnu says, so don't be greedy for those things. Just be patient, wait for the nectar. Because if we are greedy for those things and we want to enjoy them, that's again the little Hiranyakashipu there in our hearts, right? So, and then obviously, the nectar of immortality, what is that? That's pure bhakti. That makes us transfer into the immortal realm of existence, the spiritual world. So that's the pure devotional service. So, and as Vishnu is instructing, with patience and with vigorous endeavor, that nectar will be produced, right? So, yes, just to convince us a little bit that actually we can only taste that nectar when we really are able to kick out this Hiranyakashipu mentality from our hearts. I would like to share one little, it's just two sentences which Prabhupada says in the Nectar of Devotion. When I read this the first time, it actually really struck me, even though it is very simple words. But Prabhupada says, therefore, anyone who has any desire or aspiration for satisfying his senses by becoming more and more important, either in a material sense or in a spiritual sense, cannot actually relish the really sweet taste of devotional service. So I thought that was really profound. I mean, when I read this the first time, I was thinking, my God, I better give up this mentality of wanting to become a more and more important person. Otherwise, I cannot really taste the really sweet taste of devotional service. I cannot taste this nectar. I'm tasting something else. I'm tasting the temporary fruits of some ego satisfaction or whatever it may be. And I mean, let us be honest, aren't we more or less all striving to become a more and more important person, either materially or spiritually, Prabhupada says, or spiritually? So that's a pretty subtle form of this Hiranyakashipu mentality there, right? Yes, and we might not even be able to recognize it so much and identify it. Yes, so this churning process has to really bring us to that point where we actually become free of this Hiranyakashipu mentality. Otherwise, we're tasting something else. Otherwise, we're not tasting that nectar of immortality. So now, going a little bit more to the purport where Prabhupada is saying in the first sentence, it appears from this verse that politics, diplomacy, the propensities to cheat, and everything that we find in this world in individual and social negotiations between two parties are also present in the upper planetary systems. So, again, we can say, yes, this diplomacy, this almost this need for it, diplomacy, it actually also takes part internally as well. But before I go to that, I just quickly want to share one little thing from the seventh canto, which matches to this diplomacy, this tendency for diplomacy. Prabhupada says there in 7.5.7 in the purport, Chanakya Pandit says that if an honest person deals with a great cheater, it is necessary for him to become a cheater also, not for the purpose of cheating, but to make his preaching successful. Right? So that exactly expresses this tendency for diplomacy, which is going on here in the Leela. So yes, if even when we in preaching we can apply this, when we deal with a great cheater, as Chanakya Pandit says, when we deal with a person who has a bigger Hiranyakashipu there in the heart, yes, so we might also have to apply some so-called cheating techniques, but not for the sake of being a cheater, but simply to make our preaching successful, right? So, and actually we can say, even Srila Prabhupada, to some extent, he actually applied that, right? He applied that formula. He tricked us all by saying, yes, it's so easy, Krishna consciousness is so easy. Just chant and be happy. Just chant and dance and take prasad. It's so easy. Right? I mean, initially, Prabhupada did not even tell the devotees about the four regulative principles. He did not even say, right? The first initiations, from what I've heard, they took part at a Sunday feast program. Everybody just got initiated. People didn't even know anything about the four regulative principles, nothing. So, you know, and Prabhupada knew if he would have immediately, you know, given us the straight thing, the demoniac nature would have not accepted. So therefore, Prabhupada, he cheated us a little bit. He tricked us. Yes, not to become a cheater, but just to make his preaching successful. Prabhupada was very expert in this, very expert, because it is actually not so easy. It's a very fine line. Very easily, you know, in the name of preaching and making one's preaching successful, one can water things down and one can lose the spiritual content and compromise too much. But Prabhupada had that expertise. On one hand, he was just so strict and so uncompromising. But then on the other hand, he also knew when to be a little liberal, just in order to get people to take up the process. So, and then later, we started realizing, probably most of us, that actually, yes, this process of Krishna consciousness, not that easy after all, right? Yes, externally it looks so easy and simple, but internally, I remember some years ago, His Holiness Bhaktivedanta Maharaj, he was giving a class on this topic here in Mayapur, and he was saying, actually, those processes which look externally so simple, internally they're the most difficult. And the process of bhakti, it is all about transforming the heart. That's the toughest. We actually have to not only follow the four regulative principles, but we are meant to transform our likes, our dislikes. We are meant to transform these demoniac likes and dislikes to divine likes and dislikes. Yes, we are meant to transform our tastes, our worldviews, our patterns of behaviors. My God, we are meant to transform everything. Cold water. Yeah, so only when we are actually willing to transform our heart, then the grounds are prepared for pure bhakti to develop. So that's not such an easy thing. That requires a lot of deep internal work. So what looks initially so simple and easy turns out to be quite a difficult internal process, really. So, and I mean, let's face it, we do like actually the demoniac tastes and worldviews and patterns of behaviors. We like it, we attach to it. So not so easy to really actually transform. But again, this powerful churning process, incorporation under the guidance of the Lord, meaning Guru Sadhu Shastra, that eventually will get us there. Because let's be clear, our disease is really that we don't want to cooperate. We don't want to cooperate with the Lord. No, we don't. We want to stick to our systems and worldviews. We don't want to accept Krishna's system. No. So this is our disease. We are actually in uncooperation with the Lord. Definitely. We want to be independent. We want to enjoy our independence separately from the Lord. No cooperation. That's really our disease. So we do need some deeper rehabilitation, some rectification. And that's what the whole churning process is meant to bring about. So, yes, I actually, maybe at this point I will share some little things I've came across what Prabhupada says in regards to cooperation. I kind of want to make this my final theme, because as we know, cooperation in Kali Yuga, this is really one of the most toughest things, right? I mean, no matter where we go in the world, practically in every yatra, everywhere, there's some, you know, some tension, some politics going on, and. So this cooperation is really the toughest in this Kali Yuga. And why? Because of this demoniac tendencies in the hearts. That's what stops us from actually cooperating in full harmony. So Prabhupada in the first canto, he says, there is full cooperation. Actually, Prabhupada talks a lot about full cooperation, complete cooperation, total cooperation. If you put cooperation in the search function there in the folio program, you get all kinds of things, you know, how Prabhupada comments on this cooperation. So 110.6, Prabhupada says, there is full cooperation between man and God and man and nature. And this conscious cooperation between man and God and man and nature, as exemplified by King Yudhisthira, can bring about happiness, peace, and prosperity in the world. The attitude of exploiting one another, the custom of the day, will only bring misery. So interesting how Prabhupada is expressing this theme of cooperation in regards to man and God and man and nature. I mean, my God, we are all over the world, and even also within ISKCON, we're pretty far away still from that complete cooperation between man and God and man and nature. Yeah, we've got a long way to go. And then in another verse, 3.3.15, Prabhupada says, devotees of the Lord never assert independent individuality. On the contrary, they utilize their individuality in pursuit of the desires of the Lord. And this cooperation of the devotees with the Lord makes a perfect scene of the Lord's pastimes. So interesting, this independent individuality. Very easily we might be thinking, yes, individuality, we express this in such a way that we want to be independent, right? I mean, the modern days, this is all about individualism and being so special and different and unique than everybody else. So there's a high emphasis on being individual. So what Prabhupada says, no, a devotee of the Lord never asserts independent individuality. No, never. A devotee of the Lord, he utilizes his individuality in cooperation with the devotees and the Lord. No room for independent individuality. Yes. So basically, you know, in the process of devotional service, we can discover these two main tracks. The one track is Shravanam Kirtanam, and the other track is developing a genuine service attitude, meaning humble service attitude, selfless service attitude according to Vaishnav etiquette and culture, incorporation. So these two tracks, if we just concentrate on developing these tracks, then we will get there. And this, again, this churning process of cooperation, service, humble service attitude in incorporation, that's really the main purifying churning process. Just Shravanam Kirtanam alone will not get us there. No, it will not. Because very easily, you know, it's like elephant taking bath. And then after his bath, he throws back all the dirt on his back. So very easily, only Shravanam Kirtanam, without actually learning to cooperate, learning to give up this false ego patterns of behavior, and accepting Vaishnava etiquette and culture, ultimately to cultivate Trinada Pisunichina, you know, if that is not there, then we can chant and hear for many, many lifetimes actually, but we always slip back into the uncooperative, competitive, envious way of dealing with each other, and then we will never really get anywhere. In fact, it is actually in a subtle way we are performing the 10th offense to chanting the holy name, to maintain material attachments even after understanding so many instruction on this matter. We are maintaining that attachment to our ego satisfaction. And with that mood, we can't really get the benefits, the full benefits from chanting. So again, incorporation, accepting Vaishnava etiquette and culture, that's why this Vaishnava culture is such an important thing. Because without that, we will just maintain the demoniac elements and ways of behaving. And we cannot really purify our heart then. The churning process is not really fully taking place. So, and to finish off, I'd like to share one other nice thing which I came across in regards to cooperation. This is actually a room conversation here in Mayapur, 1976. Prabhupada is saying, Im Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he is God himself, Krishna himself. He felt alone, unable to do this task. He felt. So this is the position. You are cooperating, therefore I'm getting the credit. Otherwise, alone, what could I do? Ekaki amara nai pai bolo. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu himself wanted our cooperation. He is God, Krishna, and therefore cooperation is a very important thing. Nobody should think that I have got so great ability, I can do. No, it is simply by cooperation we can do very big thing. United we stand, divided we fall. This is our... So be strong in pushing on Krishna consciousness, and Krishna will help. He is the strongest. Still, we must be combined together. Sankirtan. Sankirtan means many men combined together chanting. That is Sankirtan. Otherwise, Kirtan. Sankirtan. Bahubhir Militva Kirtayeti Sankirtana. Bahu means many, many, combined together. That is Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's mission, combined together. All nations, all persons, they should combine together. There is hope in our society, combination. There are Hindus, there are Muslims, there are Christians, there are black, white, combine them. That looks very beautiful, just like combination of many flowers. There is black flower also. It looks very, very nice. Each and every flower, take alone, it is not beautiful. But when they are combined together, it looks very beautiful. It is attractive, and that is wanted. Because from the spiritual platform, we are all working. Pandita Samadarshanaha. Spiritual platform, every one of us, we are servant of Krishna. So where is the competition between one servant with another? There is, even there is competition, the center is Krishna, who can serve more. Therefore, that competition is very welcome because there is no personal interest. Everyone is trying how to serve Krishna more. That is wanted. The competition is there in his real form and perverted form. In the real form, Krishna is the center, and in the perverted form, I am the center. I compete with you to satisfy my senses more. What is called heliocentric or And then Pushta Krishna says, egocentric. And Prabhupada, egocentric. Yes, this is egocentric to Mahakrishna. It should be Krishna-centric. Prabhupada, yes, then it is perfect. The competition must remain. The others, they say, why competition? Make it zero. That is imperfect. But competition to satisfy Krishna, that is reality. So Prabhupada has very broad vision, you know, of this cooperation. Muslims, Christians, Hindus, combine them. All nations, combine. That's true Sankirtan. Cooperation, combining with Krishna in the center. Okay, time is up, and this is basically all I wanted to share. So maybe we have some corrections, additions, comments, questions, whatever. Yes, Prabhu?
Hare Krishna. So one thing about cooperation is that it can be a little difficult because we see it seems through my own mind that
yes.
Everyone has different goals, everyone has different philosophy, everyone has different levels of faith, and everyone has different kind of ideas of how they want to do things, you know.
So yes.
how especially like yourself included, you know, you think you're got the, you know what to do, you know. So how to actually kind of everyone cooperate, you know?
Well, we have to cooperate under senior guidance. That's the thing. Because I once heard a good statement, I think it comes from Radha Swami. If our enthusiasm is not guided by a higher intelligence than our own, we easily become fanatics. So that's one thing that can make cooperation difficult, because in our more neophyte stage, which we all are, our enthusiasm is not pure. It's mixed with the mode of passion, with false ego, thinking, I know my vision is the best. And very easily our intelligence gets affected by that, right? So that's why we need to have guidance from a higher intelligence than our own. And then, you know, it is possible, actually. It is possible. And also, I mean, there's always different, so many different ways we can do one thing. There's not one right way and every other way is wrong, right? In any kind of attempts, there's so many ways. But naturally, we always think our way is the best. So cooperation means that we are willing, you know, to let go of our ways of doing and adjust to other proposals, other ways of doing it, for the sake of in cooperation to do things together and get there together. And I mean, we know Prabhupada was saying, your love for me will be shown in how much you cooperate. Yes. So, yeah, this cooperation is really the toughest. It is. Not only sometimes. Yes, Prabhu. Somebody knows how to operate this? Okay.
Thank you very much for the wonderful class. You brought up chant and be happy. My research
try.
It seemed to be something that different things he said indicated. It was a good marketing term for some time, maybe. I was curious if you could give us a new marketing term for the brand of Krishna consciousness that you're referring to in this class and in general with the quotes that you've offered from Srila Prabhupada.
Oh, wow, you know, so now you're putting me on the spot here, new marketing term. I mean, to really come up with a good one, I would need a little bit of time to think about it, I think. Well, I mean, I don't know if this is what you would like to hear, but what comes to my mind is, you know, in regards to my humble preaching efforts, my mood is definitely boiling the milk. And there's these famous letters where Prabhupada said, that was already 1972, Prabhupada was saying, so now we've got so many centers, we have so many students, so Don't be so concerned in spreading yourself more and more widely. You know, let's just train those devotees which we have, and we boil the milk. And just like boiling the milk, it becomes thicker and sweeter. Do like that. Boil the milk. And especially in regards to chanting the holy name. Yeah, I mean, in my humble opinion, holy name retreats are very powerful tools to really try and get on deeper understandings and deeper levels of chanting. It's just not such a quick and cheap thing, you know? And we do tend to take this chanting very lightly, very externally, just walking around Nishnishwamam and even in Kirtan, you know, we tend to think, oh, it's just for our fun jumping around and. But that the chanting in Japa and Kirtan, it's all about connecting, calling out, crying out, re-establishing this relationship, turning mindfully towards Krishna when we chant. This we easily can completely miss. Yes. I mean, I'm making some humble attempt to conduct holy name retreats. We had one in Echo Chakra over Christmas and in other parts of the world also. And yeah, sometimes devotees share with me afterwards. They share, wow, you know, for the last 30 years, I realize I've been doing something else. I have not been chanting the holy name. I've been just, you know, mechanically rattling something down here. I, you know, I thought I was doing all right, but wow, now I realize I've been doing something else. So these feedbacks I'm sometimes getting, and I'm not saying that to glorify my holy name retreats, but I'm just the tour guide there capturing people and try to, you know, help them to open their heart and get on deeper levels and so on. So yeah, boiling the milk, that's where it's at, I think. And then we will maybe one day come to this platform where we can actually truly chant the holy name and we actually experience some happiness, you know? Yes. We taste some nectar there, you know? Yes. I don't know how long we should go. Okay, till 9 o'clock. All right.
Hare Krishna Mataji, thank you for a wonderful class. Actually, I have a question regarding chanting only. Like you are telling that in chanting we should cry out the whole, to Krishna for help. So generally Prabhupada used to say that we simply should, while chanting we simply should hear.
Yes.
So how these two things can happen? We can try these two things simultaneously. Like we are crying out for Krishna and and
so now we are getting into the holy name. Yes, well, Prabhupada did not only say we should hear, but he actually in one quote he says we should hear ourselves chant sincerely. Try and hear yourself chant sincerely. You know, so, and Prabhupada also gave us this analogy of the child crying out in helplessness for his mother. That's actually a very deep analogy. A child, you know, who's crying out for his mother, he feels such desperation, such urgency. Where is my mother? I need her right now. With that kind of feeling, we are meant to chant, actually. And a child who cries out for his mother in such a mood, that child doesn't have the problem of a wandering mind. Right? Very clear. The child is not saying, oh, this is strange. Whenever I cry out for my mother, I'm thinking of so many other things with whom to play and what to do and my friends and all that. No, no. There's no room for that. All the child can think of is, where's my mother? I need her right now. And that's how we are meant to chant, actually. So the real solution, you know, for example, to the wandering mind is actually to involve the heart, to bring the holy name on the level of the heart and in desperation crying out for Krishna. And why is this so difficult for us? Because of our pride. That's why we can't actually feel helpless. We don't feel hopelessly dependent on Krishna because of our pride. So that's why Mahaprabhu says, Tinadapi Sinitana. So only in that state of mind, more humble than a blade of grass, more tolerant than a tree, only then we can actually cry out in helplessness. So that's why Guru Govinda Maharaj gives us this wonderful formula. He says, an ISKCON temple is a crying school where we learn how to cry out to Krishna. And that's actually the essence of the whole Krishna conscious practice, to really get there. You know, that we cry out in desperation, in helplessness. Okay, 9 o'clock. I'll finish on that note. Thank you kindly. Srila Prabhupada ki, Ganta Chimad Bhagavatam ki, Samaveda Bhaktavinda ki, Guru Premanandi, Hari Hari Vara, Hare Krishna.